Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Rita Chaudhary of the Department of Ancient Indian History and Culture, University of Calcutta. Our subject is Indian culture. Our paper is on Indian polity and our module is on the Arthashastra. Now, the Arthashastra, you must understand, is a very important work on statecraft for early India. We have spoken of it in our previous modules, and we will see now how important it is to understand the kind of statecraft that existed in early India. Our objectives are to study the Arthashastra and its importance as an indigenous text. We will analyze the authorship of the text because there are contrary opinions in this regard. We will analyze the contents and the various aspects of administration, such as kingship, the Saptanga theory, administration, foreign policy, and taxation. Now, in the context of Saptanga theory, we must realize by now that we have analyzed that in our previous modules, but here we will understand, we will explain the context of that, of the contents of the text. Now, in the introduction, we will go on to the history of the Mauryan Empire, which extended from c 325 to 185 BCE, and it has been amply highlighted by a great number and diverse type of sources. The value of many of these sources are greatly enhanced because they are more or less contemporary to the said period. In this context, the indigenous text, the Arthashastra of Kautilya, is of immense importance. The Arthashastra is an exceptional treatise on statecraft, comprising of 15 books and 150 chapters, traditionally written by Kautilya, also known as Chanakya, chief minister of Chandragupta, the first Mauryan emperor. In it, Kautilya provides practical and imaginative advice on how ideally a king should organize, govern, defend, and expand his realm, being just and benevolent, though prescriptive and watchful at home, but aggressive and deceitful in his foreign policy. Now, from all that we have said, you must be noting that he has analyzed a varied aspect of the administration of early India. But it is merely a prescriptive text. He has just analyzed what he understands should be the administration and not in reality what existed at that time. We go on to the authorship of the text. Now, this is a very controversial question because we will see that there are divergent opinions in this regard. The opinion among scholars are divided on the question as to who was the real author of the Arthashastra. The political landscape and many things mentioned in the treatise closely match what is known of the Nanda Mauryan period from other literature, Ashokan inscriptions and archaeology. In discussion of various viewpoints, Kautilya's is always last and decisive. Many scholars, therefore, support the attribution of authorship to Kautilya, arguing that some apparent anachronisms and alterations in viewpoint can be explained as interpolations and alterations by later commentators. Others, however, find these discrepancies most significant and argue that the text was compiled later, perhaps by Vishnugupta, named at the end. Alternatively, this is another name of Kautilya. So we understand that there is a suggestion of multiple authorship of this text. We will go on to some modern research that has been undertaken, which tries to fix the date of the text. Now, Thomas Trottmann undertook a detailed computer-based statistical analysis of the Arthashastra, revealing stylistic inconsistencies that imply multiple authorship. He considers that the author was a later scholar, working perhaps around 250 CE, who brought together a number of earlier treatises, abridging but not otherwise altering them. However, the earliest portion of the text, namely the Adhyaksha Procharo section, concerning the heads of administrative departments, has been assigned by Trottmann to 3rd century BCE. Thus, at least this portion, Book 2, is contemporary to Mauryan times and can be used as a primary material for the study of the period, though it cannot be ascertained that it was written by a Mauryan minister. So, from what that we have said is that there is actually no one opinion regarding as to who has written the Arthashastra. Now, normally what scholars do is that attribute it to Chanakya, and they say that he was the minister of Chandragupta Maurya. But now, after a detailed analysis of the text, scholars have come up with different opinions, which I have analyzed in the last portion. We can go on to contents, which is varied, and we have various kinds of analysis in that regarding the governance and administration. The Arthashastra, as a manual on statecraft, is famous for its pragmatic approach to polity and its trust on financial material matters, arthaiva pradhanam, for the successful management of the realm. A perusal of the contents of the text reveals the ingenuity of the author in highlighting almost every aspect of administrative setup, which are prerequisites for organizing a strong centralized empire. Book 1, named Vinayadhikarinam, introduces the treatise's contents. Kautilya then argues that Dandoniti, the science of government, is the most important of the social sciences. The others being Anvikshaki, philosophy of Shankho, Jogo and Lokayata, Troi, the triple Vedas, and Varta, agriculture, cattle breeding and trade. Dandoniti is concerned with the appropriate use of legitimate force. A ruler must achieve a just balance between excessive severity, which excites revolt, and excessive mildness, which encourages contempt for authority. Book 1 continues with the education of a prince, the value of self-control, the importance of wise counselors whose advice the king heeds, and their selection and the use of spies to check their probity. Now, it discusses additionally the administrative work of the king's council, Mantri Parishad, the role of envoys to foreign governments, how the king should ensure his personal safety, including protection against his wives and sons, the duties of a good king, and the organization of the harem. Book 2, Adhyaksha Procharo, is titled The Duties of Government Superintendents. It first considers the ideal human landscape, the form and distribution of settlements, the foundation of new villages to make unoccupied areas productive through agriculture, mining and forest management, and the creation and layout of fortified cities. It then focuses on the bureaucracy, the duties of senior officials such as collecting taxes, monitoring work, debriefing spies and keeping accounts. detecting and punishing fraudulent or neglectful officials, assessing the quality of goods for the Royal Treasury. We will further elaborate on the Udbhakko Procharo, because as I have already said, it constitutes the main portion of the text and it is contemporary with the Mauryan period, considered to be contemporary with the Mauryan period. So it discusses how officials should monitor and manage the industry, the mint, the tax revenues, trade and forest production, the armory, weights and measures, toll collection, the agricultural productivity of the crown lands, game and butchery, taxing and protecting prostitutes and educating their children, shipping, the welfare of state-owned cattle, horses and elephants, military matters, including chariot construction, training equipment and regimental organization, passports and road security. It ends with recommendations on tax assessment, recruiting spies to observe people throughout society, and a city superintendent's various other duties. Book 3 is entitled Dharmasthiyam. It discusses all aspects of law, legal agreements and settlement of disputes, marriage and inheritance, property, land disputes and agriculture, debt and financial matters, slavery and employment relations, theft, defamation, assault, state regulation of gambling, and a range of offenses. Kautilya offers guidance on proper legal procedures, individuals' legal rights and duties, including provisions to protect slaves from ill treatment, appropriate punishment, which are generally fines, but also public humiliation, banishment, mutilation, and death. Book 4, entitled Kontakho Shodhanam, means removal of thorns. It is concerned with ensuring public order and welfare. It discusses the regulation of work and employment, commerce and protection against commercial deception, provisions for averting natural hazards, including preventing fines by thinning the rich tax, or in other words, taxing them heavily, crime prevention, including using spies as agents, provocateurs to entrap would-be criminals, methods to identify the cause of suspicious deaths, the legal use of torture, and when it is not permitted, the indispensability of reliable evidence, and the punishments for many crimes. Book 5 is entitled Jogobittam. It discusses ways of preventing treason, including underhanded secret measures to get rid of untrustworthy ministers. Kautilya recommends salaries for state posts and considers how to raise emergency revenue, such as through public donations, using spy donors to inspire generosity and shame those backward in giving. He then discusses what makes a good courtier, including advising the king well. Counselors should also conceal a king's terminal illness or sudden death until the heir apparent is fit to take over. Book 7 is Mandala Joni. It takes a closer look at the virtues required of the king. It then discusses foreign policy. In principle, all neighboring states are natural enemies, against whom more distant states are potential allies. Book 7 is Sharagunnam, develops the theme of Book 6, discussing situations favoring policies of peace alliances, neutrality, deterrent war preparations, and war itself, aiming always to benefit the king's own state. For example, weaker states should be attacked Alliances should be made with stronger kings and broken when circumstances change. We continue with the contents of Book 7, where Kautilya discusses how a king may break up alliances against him, discusses how to defeat a powerful enemy by creating alliances, encouraging tribal raids or other stratagems, and in the last resort, advises flight or negotiation rather than a heroic death. Finally, Kautilya discusses making and breaking peace, the security of oaths, the selection of expendable hostages, and ways to engineer one's hostage escape. Book 8 is Vashanadi Karinam. It considers how to deal with disaster. Kautilya shows the interdependence of the king, his ministers, and his people. The king is responsible for appointing suitable ministers, ministers for ensuring that everything is properly run, and the people for working to create wealth and maintain defenses. Thus, disasters in one sphere will have repercussions in others. Kautilya examines potential sources of problems such as defects in the king's character, natural disasters, inappropriate behavior by officials, robbers and wild tribes, and mismanagement. Book 9 is entitled Obhyakshata Karma. The book returns to international relations, arguing that in achieving conquest, skill in intrigue is more effective than power or enthusiasm. He considers the factors involved in planning and executing a campaign, including terrain, timing, and military strength. He discusses the desirable size and composition of the army, its equipment and training, how to avert treachery at home or external threats while in the field, and how to assess the advantages and disadvantages of military action. Book 10 is entitled Shangramikam. It concerns the practicalities of warfare, such as routes, encampments, and provisioning, when, where, and how to attack, the disposition of infantry, cavalry, chariotry, and war elephants, various strategic formations, and the army's command structure. Book 11 is Shanghavrittam. It returns to the subject of intrigue, discussing ways to suborn or destroy the cooperation of enemy states. Book 12 is Obholiyasham. It considers how a king may make the best of submission to a more powerful enemy. On the one hand, by placating him with gifts of men, wealth or lands, using the opportunity to offload unreliable troops, uncontrollable horses or elephants, unsaleable goods or land threatened by other enemies. On the other, by undermining the enemy's power by intrigue, such as using spies to create dissension, encouraging guerrilla warfare, and provoking attacks on the enemy by other states. Kautilya also described ways to murder and capture enemy ruler, and if all fails, how the king may make his own escape. Book 13 is entitled Durga Labhapayo. It is actually means strategic means to capture a fortress. According to it, initially, the king should foster belief in his own powers and the god's favor towards him. Heartening his followers and discouraging the enemy, undermining the standing of the enemy king, and planting spies to create dissension in the enemy's court. When an enemy is safe in his fortress, other states should be encouraged to lay waste to his lands, while the king destroys the enemy's trade, industry, and agriculture. We continue with the contents of Book 13. Only when the enemy's resources are thus reduced should the king attack the fortress using siege engines, men and fire. Tempt the enemy out by pretending to lift the siege and send spies to infiltrate the fortress. Once the king has conquered the enemy lands, he must win over its population by his generosity and good governance. Book 14 is entitled Upanishadikam. It considers the secret means to rid the kingdom of wicked individuals. For example, using spies to poison them or set their houses on fire. Kautilya discusses various concoctions and their uses, including medicines, coloring agents and potions to protect the army or cause harm to the enemy. Some are accompanied by sacrifices. Book 15 is entitled Tantra Jukti. The work is rounded off with a description of its forms and the various ways its contents are presented, ending with justifications for its compilation, rescuing political science after Nanda misrule and the inadequacy of other scholars' commentaries. Now, it is evident from the contents of the chapters that Kautilya has discussed a wide variety of subjects relating to the administration and the steps that were to be taken by the ruler for good governance. Now, it is also noticeable from this that all the steps that he advises to be taken are not to follow a just and honest ways. There are also advices to take any kind of deceitful, resort to any kind of deceitful act that might help the ruler in his achieving his aims and goals. So, and the chapters have discussed minutely every aspect of administration. So, we are indeed surprised at the uniqueness of the mind of a great writer, or maybe a multiple of writers who devised such a text where all aspects of administration has been, its good side including its bad sides, have been discussed in so much of details. And this is why Kautilya's Arthashastra is a unique text on statecraft and ethics. Now, we have in these chapters references to various aspects of administration which we will now want to discuss. Some of the more important aspects of the administrative setup are kingship. The king was the most important figure in the body politic and he performed multidimensional functions. The Saptanga theory, a state rajya, was considered to be of seven limbs or seven elements. Administration. With the advent of the Mauryas on the political stage of India, bureaucracy developed as a well-organized hierarchical cadre-based administrative system. Now, some of the more important aspects of the administrative setup are foreign policy is summed up in the formula Sarguna or six measures. The formula is associated with, though it does not necessarily presuppose, the theory of Rajamandala or circle of kings. Taxation. The Mauryan rulers possessed knowledge of the principles of taxation and were therefore able to establish an organized system of taxation. Now we will discuss each and every aspect in some details. It is of course not necessary to discuss minute details. So we go on to the more important aspect and we begin with kingship. The king's functions involved the protection not only of his kingdom against external aggression, but also of life, property and traditional customs against internal foes. He protected the purity of class and caste by ensuring that those who challenged the system were excommunicated. He protected the family system by punishing adultery and ensuring the fair inheritance of family property. He protected widows and orphans by making them his wards. He protected the rich against the poor by suppressing robbery. And he protected the poor against the rich by punishing extortion and oppression. Religion was protected by liberal grants to learned Brahmins and temples, and frequently to heterodox sects also. The ideal set before the king was one of energetic beneficence. The Arthashastra, despite its advocacy of every dishonest expedient for acquisition and maintenance of power, puts forward the kingly duty in simple and forceful language, setting an ideal which few ancient civilizations can boast of. Comparing the king and the ascetic, it says, I quote, in the happiness of his subjects lies the king's happiness. In the welfare of his subjects, his welfare. The king's good is not that which pleases him, but that which pleases his subjects. I unquote. Now, the daily routine of the king has been also been set forward in the Arthashastra. The Arthashastra suggests a timetable for the king's day, which allows him only 4.5 hours of sleep and 3 hours for eating and recreation. The rest of the day being spent in state affairs of one kind or another. No doubt, such a program was rarely kept in practice, but it at least shows the ideal at which the king was expected to aim for. In all sources, the king is told that he must be prompt in the administration of justice and always be accessible to his people. The best of Indian kings at all times have made the public audience or darbar an important instrument of government. Now, we see that the Arthashastra concentrates on the king, his characters and what was expected of him. Now, you must understand that Kautilya actually was supporting monarchy, because at other places we find that he is against those states which were ruled by oligarchies or otherwise. His aim was to strengthen the monarchy at any cost. We go on to another important aspect of the Arthashastra, the Saptanga theory. According to the Dharma Shastra of Manu and the Shanti Parva of Mahabharata, including of course the Arthashastra, the state consisted of 7 limbs, Saptanga. The Arthashastra has enlisted these 7 elements of Prakritis as follows. Shami, the king or the head of the state, the Amato, Montri or Sochiva, secretary, Janapada, populated territory, Durgo, fort or the fortified urban area, possibly the capital, Kosho, the treasury, Bolo, force, Dondo or the rod, denoting the army, and lastly, the Mitro, a friend or ally. According to the scheme, each preceding element is more important than each succeeding element. The Swami is the foremost element, followed by the Amato, and the Mitro, being of the least importance, is placed at the end. The graded importance of these elements is judged not in terms of their normal condition, but in the degree of the affliction under calamitous condition or distress, that is Vashana. The greater the degree of affliction of the element, limb, by the calamity, the more is the importance of the prakriti or the ongo. The calamity affects the swami more seriously than affecting the amatto. So the swami is above the amatto. Though the swami is unanimously viewed as the most important limb of the body politic, each ongo or limb has a prescribed and specific function, which can be rendered best by that specific ongo and not by any other limb. Obviously, this concept upholds that each and every limb, in spite of their graded importance, was indispensable and beneficial to six others. Now, before we go on to the administration, we make a review of the Saptanga theory. In our previous modules, we have discussed the theory in great detail, and we see that a large number of authors, ancient Indian authors, have given a great emphasis of the state constituting of these seven elements. And you may recapitulate that in the organic theory regarding the origin of the state, we have said that the state constitutes of a number of elements, and it is very important that they should be interdependent of one another and not work individually. Now we go on to aspects of administration, which has been discussed by Kautilya. The Arthashastra of Kautilya mentions 18 tithas, which are probably called mahamatras or high functionaries. The term mahamatra is actually used only on a few occasions in the Arthashastra, its real counterpart being amatto, though it is quite familiar in the Ashokan inscriptions. In addition to the 18 tithas, Kautilya provides in some detail accounts of 27 superintendents or adhyakshas, concerned mostly with economic functions and some military duties, though social functions were not ignored. All the Megasthenes and the Ashokan inscriptions have nothing to say on the rules of recruitment. Kautilya lays down certain qualifications for the cadre of high officers known as amattas, the emphasis being on noble birth. That this bureaucracy was highly hierarchical is suggested by the pay scale of different categories of employees. The highest functionaries such as Mantrin, Purohit, Senapati and Juvaraj received 48,000 panos. In contrast, the lowest officials received 60 panos, and at other places they were given as small as a pittance, as only 10 or 20 panos. This shows a pyramidal bureaucratic structure. With the help of the centralized bureaucratic structure, not only did the government regulate the economic life of the country, but it also took an important part in it. All mines, including pearl beds, fisheries and salt pans, were owned by the state and were either worked directly with the labor of criminals or serfs, or let out to entrepreneurs from whom the king claimed a percentage of their output as royalty. On this ground, A.L. Basham, in his Wonder That Was India, opines that there was no question of laissez-faire in ancient India. Now, before we go on to the espionage system, it is apparent from what we have discussed so far that the Mauryan Empire was a highly centralized state. We have seen that how they controlled every aspect of economy and the political structure, and little was left to the enterprise of private producers. So, and this aspect of administration will be further elaborated in the contents of our lecture. Now, we go on to the espionage system. In brief, the espionage system consisted of the Samahatta as the head of the secret service, and amongst others, the shangstha, the stationary, shancharo or roving, and ubhoy beton, who is akin to a double agent. It is noticeable that both men and women were employed as secret agents. It is apparent that to maintain a huge centralized structure, Kautilya has emphasized on the gathering of secret information on the activities of high-ranking officers, watching over officers of the finance department, invigilating upon the suspicious element, and the application of force, fraud, and dubious means to eliminate them. Now, before we find an elaboration of the centralized nature of administration of the Mauryan Empire from the system of espionage, which was very elaborate and which employed both men and women in various garbs to find out information from the various categories of people. Now we go on to a very important aspect of administration that has been described by Kautilya, and that is foreign policy. Now what he says is that the state consisted of a structure which resembled a mandala, and he calls it the Raja Mandala. Now, in the middle is the king, the strong king, the would-be conqueror. So we see what kind of kings or administrators that we have within the Raja Mandala. The Mandala is said to consist of 12 kings. They were the Vijigishu, or the would-be conqueror. The Ori, the enemy, whose territory is contiguous to that of the Vijigishu. The Mitro, the Vijigishu's ally, with territory immediately beyond that of the Ori. The Ori Mitro, the enemy's ally, with territory beyond that of the Mitro. The Mitro Mitro, the ally of the Vijigishu's ally, with territory beyond that of the Ori Mitro. Ori Mitro, the ally of the enemy's ally, beyond the Mitro Mitro. Now this is what we see in front. Now it is, he says that behind there is another mandala which also consists of 12 kings. They are the Pashni Groho, the enemy in the rear of the Vijigishu. Akrando, the Vijigishu's ally in the rear, with territory behind that of the Pashni Groho. Pashni Grohoshar, the ally of the Pashni Groho, behind the Akrando. The Akrandoshar, the ally of the Akrando, behind the Pashni Grohoshar. Muttamo, the middle king, with territory adjoining those of the Vijigishu and the Ori, and stronger than either of these. Udashin, the king lying outside, or indifferent or neutral king, more powerful than the Vijigishu, the Ori, and the Muttamo. Now, what we learn from this is there is a very simple principle behind this. He makes it out from this Raja Mandala that the state just beside the Vijigishu is his enemy. And the state just behind, at the side of the Ori, is his Mitro. So, according to him, a state lying beside us, even today we realize the truth of this policy, is that just the neighboring state cannot be the friend of the Vijigishu or the central government or the central state. So this is the policy that is followed, and the 12 states are described according to this principle. The formula of Shadguna, which sums up foreign policy, consists of 6 gunas of policies. That is, the first one is Shundi, making a treaty containing conditions of terms, that is the policy of peace. Vigraha, the policy of hostility. Ashana, the policy of remaining quiet and not planning to march on an expedition, Jano marching on an expedition, Shangstroye seeking shelter with another king or in a fort, Doidi Bhavo, the double policy of Shondi with one king and Vigroho with another at the same time. One of the earlier teachers, Vatavedi, had expressed the view that there are only two policies, peace and war, and that the other policies are only aspects of these two. Kautilya himself, however, favors the sixfold classification, as there are different situations which call for different policies. The purpose of all the policies is to grow stronger in the long run than the enemy, though sometimes one may have to tolerate temporarily the greater strength of the enemy. Another part of this foreign policy is the supervision of foreigners. Now, in our previous discussion, the portion that we have just discussed, we see how he uses expedient to determine what kind of policy a king can follow. He divides it among what a strong king, what kind of policy a strong king can follow during wars, and what kind of policy a king who finds himself weak should follow so that he is not utterly destroyed. Now, another part of the foreign policy of Kautilya is the supervision of foreigners. In the Arthashastra, the superintendent of commerce, the Panna Daksha, has been given the responsibility to exempt from debts those foreigners importing merchandise who are not a part of local associations and partners. The superintendent of tolls, Shulkar Daksha, had the responsibility of supervising the foreign merchants. When these merchants came at the gate of the city, they had to come to the toll house where there were four or five collectors who took down the names of the merchants from where they have come, the amount of merchandise they had bought, where for the first time the seal mark had been made on the merchandise. Moreover, masters of houses had to report any strangers arriving at or departing from their houses to the city superintendents. Otherwise, they would be guilty of offense committed during that night. Even during safe nights, they were to be fined 3 ponos. Spies and the guise of householders employed by the states were to find out the causes of emigration and immigration of persons of migratory habit, the arrival and departure of men and women of condemnable character, as well as the movement of foreign spies. Now, we go on to taxation. So, from the previous discussion, we find that he has also advised that the king should keep a strong control over the goings and the activities that the foreigners were undertaking in the state that where he is ruling, so that he could know that there is no disruption to normal life and an obstruction to good governance. We go on to taxation. The Mauryan rulers possessed knowledge of the principles of taxations and were therefore able to establish an organized system of taxation. Kautilya mentions that taxes must be levied on all merchandise intended for sale and must be fixed once and for all. The implication that fiscal productiveness must be able to cover the government expenditure is present in the remark of Kautilya. The quality of a good country lies in its capability of supporting the expenditure. The principles of elasticity and diversity were known by the Mauryan rulers. The principle of elasticity enabled the state to increase its financial resources in a state of emergency. The principle of diversity can be seen in the multiplicity of taxes, which included taxes on land, tolls, custom duties, and taxes on sale of commodities. However, Kautilya ends with a word of caution. I quote, "He, the king, should take from the kingdom fruits as they ripen, as from a garden. He should avoid unripe fruit that causes an uprising for fear of its destruction." Now, we have discussed the main aspects of the administration on which he elaborates. There are innumerable amount of details that he has given, but we should understand that what he intends doing. Now, he has given us the principles that a king or a state should follow in order to ensure its success, and that a government is not distracted by centrifugal elements. The maintenance of a state structure for nearly 140 years was a momentous achievement. The paramount position of the Mauryas was largely created by the military might and administrative control. The success of the latter was considerably due to an effective espionage service in which the Mauryas were pioneers, as evident in other aspects of the mighty imperial administrative structure. Now, one thing that you must keep in mind is that Kautilya has proposed an ideal. It was something, all the policies that he has advocated was something that he wished an imperial ruler to follow. And actually, there is no reference to any real incident. So it is a prescriptive text, and we expect that some of the Mauryan rulers, the stronger ones, tried to follow what Kautilya had advocated. Now, if you want to know more about the other aspects of administration, you can visit EPG Pathshala, and you will find a huge amount of information from the other modules. Thank you.